So what we have been studying is a statistical system with multiple components. So let me write out some relevant equation. So we introduce several parameters that are associated with these individual components. So I is the ith component. So Ti is, I also use the symbol beta I. Then you have mu I, Pi, rho I, and I minus I. So rho I is the energy density, ni is the number density, and this is the entropy density. And as we have been emphasizing, the two are independent. Two of the six are independent. And I'll write down some of the equations that we'll be using today, okay, involving this. So one is this. So these three equations are universal, and then there is a fourth equation that is the equation of state. Okay, which you can write in various forms, but essentially what it does is that it expresses one of these variables in terms of the other. Okay. So with the help of these four equations, 1, 2, 3 and the equation of state, we can relate these four of these to the other two. Yeah, and which two you take to be independent is up to you. Then we also said that if we have conserved charge M tilde L, suppose these are the conserved charges, and not every ni is conserved, not every particle number is conserved, then these mu i's are not all independent. We can put really a relationship between the mu i's, and that relation is of the following form, that mu I is given by sum over L. Let me write here, L runs from 1 to L. So that's the number of conserved charges. So we take these as the independent variables and not all mu i's. Okay, so this so far is the statistical mechanics. Now when we go to cosmology, then thermal equilibrium means all the TIs are equal.
Strictly speaking, if the little ni's are not conserved, then the mu I doesn't really make sense, right? Because you only introduce a chemical potential for a conserved charge.
That is true. That is true. But if we just think of them as a system of ideal gas, right? Then you can still introduce their mu I's, right? At any given temperature, you have certain mixture, right? And you can, introduce the mu I's. Is that as the system evolves, right? As the system evolves, these individual NIs will not be conserved, right? So the mu I's will change accordingly, right? So the point is, let me put it this way, that it is true that these mu I's make sense only if it's conserved.
Yeah.
But let's suppose that we have just the ith component. We don't mix them. Right? Then you can introduce mu I. Right? So I'm introducing mu I only in that sense. That this is a mu I associated with, if you just had the ith component and nothing else, right, then you will write it in a chemical potential, and that's what this mu I refers to. Right? When you mix them up, then each of these mu I's will be expressed in terms of these mu tildes. If they are really interacting in such a way that the partition function itself gets affected, then it is true that the mu I's will not make sense. Right? But we are, assuming that the partition function itself is not getting affected, that at any equilibrium temperature, it's just the sum of the partition functions of individual components. But they can exchange as the universe evolves, these numbers can get changed. Because it is in this sense you have to think of this device. Is that point clear? Okay. That if there is really if the partition function itself have to take into account each interaction, which changes the number densities, numbers. Then there is no way you can even introduce a mu i's. Okay, because then the ni's are not even good quantum numbers, right? When you write e to the power minus beta mu I ni, okay, these ni's are not even good quantum numbers of a quantum state, right? Because a given quantum state will be a superposition of many states with different ni's. So we are not assuming that at the level of the partition function, their interaction Hamilton is important, right? So from that perspective, we can still talk about the NIs, okay? Just like it's like when you have ideal gas, right? We introduce the notion of ideal gas, okay? But we know that the strictly ideal gas cannot have any thermal equilibrium. So here, the sense in which you are introducing these mu i's, okay, even though they are not strictly defined, is that these ni's you are still thinking of them as defined, but they can get exchanged between particles as the system evolves. Okay. But in any equilibrium situation, we are assuming that we can still talk about the ni's.
So, if we have to consider interaction,
yes,
to account, sufficient contribution of interaction.
Yeah.
So then we can just break the log of Q in terms of the
sum over Qi. Exactly.
Right.
That's exactly the point. Right. I mean, here we are, because you are saying the log of Q is still sum over log Qi's.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right? That's why you can talk about the individual mu i's.
Yeah. In the mu i's are expressed in terms of mu tildes.
Yes, that will be expressed in terms of the mu tildes.
But
you can still talk about the individual mu i's.
Right.
Because you are assuming the log Q is just the sum over log Qi's.
Right.
In a truly interacting system,
right,
that is not the case. Right. Log Q is not the sum of log Qi's, right? You have taken down an interaction.
So that log Q for a sum over L, that L, mu tilde.
Yes.
Log Q is not, log Q can be written as a sum over that L summation.
I don't know exactly. So, we are using this formula, right? Log Qi. So log Qi is just the free Qi that he wrote down. Okay. If the interactions are really important, then this is not true. Right? And indeed, you can try to write in terms of sum over the log individual systems, but it's not completely clear that can always be done. Right? That the system, even though there are some conserved charges, right, It need not mean that the system just decouples into a set of L in individual components. Okay, so we are talking about mu1 only because of this. That we are still assuming that this log qi, it's a sum of log qi's. Okay, so the equations we have b b p of sum I equal to 1 to k ci l ni a q equal to 0. This is for l equal to 1 to l. We have the energy conservation equation b b t of sum over I equal to 1 to k rho I cube is minus 3 s square a dot sum over I equal to 1 to k, right? And finally, the Friedman equation a dot over a plus k over s square 8 pi g over 3 sum over I equal to 1 to rho y plus rho lambda. Okay, so the cosmological constant term I am now writing separately. Okay. And as we discussed last time, the number of equations is the number of variables. So there are L plus 2 equations, okay. And the variables that we have to use are A, T, and mu tilde is. Okay, so you have equal number of equations and variables. So what we want to do today is to use these equations to derive certain, to find certain consequences, and there will be disconnected results as of today, okay, but later on we will try to connect them up. We will see, try to see how to make use of them. Okay, so today we are just going to derive some relations without actually saying how to use them, okay, in cosmology, but in the later lectures we will see how to make use of this. So the first equation that we will derive is the entropy conservation. So we define S as sum I equal to 1 to this side, and you want to prove that d dt of s a cube is 0, okay, as a consequence of these equations. Okay. Which basically tells us that the entropy doesn't change during cosmological evolution, okay, assuming that everything is in equilibrium. Which shouldn't surprise you, of course, right? Because if things are in equilibrium, entropy shouldn't change. Okay, but we'll see formally how to prove this.
Means even if from the thermal equilibrium, it make transition to individual individual energy conservation state.
Yeah. So then entropy can change.
Then entropy can change. So this is the statement only throughout the evolution where thermal equilibrium will remain.
Exactly. When these relations are valid. Right? Because here you are assuming thermal equilibrium, right? All components are the same temperature. Okay? In this case, we will prove this as a consequence of these equations.
Is the cube the co-moving entropy?
Yes, this is the entropy in a given co-moving column, exactly. Okay, the fact that S falls from as 1 over A cube, right, is simply the expansion of the universe. Right? The total entropy content in a given co-moving column doesn't change. Is this statement clear? Okay, so let's try to see how to prove this. So the left hand side, okay, let me write ddt of sum over I si a cube, right? This is what we are trying to calculate. So this is sum over I dsi dt times a cube plus 3 a square a dot si. So what we are going to do, let me say in words and then I will erase this. Okay. So this dsi dt, okay, let me write this here. So dsi dt, I will write in other words, we will just think of si as a function of rho I and ni. Any two we can take to be independent, right? Just think of si as a function of rho I and ni. And then I can write dsi dt as a sum of these two. And then for del si del rho I, I will use 1 over ti. And for del si del ni, I will use minus mu I over ti. Okay? So let me erase this. What? This is sum over I minus 1 over ti d rho I dt a cube plus mu I over ti d ni dt a cube. Okay, that's this part. And then here, for SI, I'm going to use this.
Why is the first term is negative and second term is?
Why is the first term?
Because the equation is something like del SI del rho I is equal to 1 by TI.
Oh, yeah. So this is opposite sign, right? 1 over TI and minus TI. So here I'm going to substitute this.
Small SI,
yeah, everything is being done in small SI. Okay, because there's a volume. In cosmology, of course, there's a volume. Okay, so you do everything in terms of the intrinsic quantities. So you get plus 3 over T A square A dot and then this. Pi plus Ui minus Ui. So I'm going to erase this. 3 over T. And here, of course, I'm going to use T instead of TI because of thermal equilibrium. Is this clear? So now I'm going to, you see, here is d rho I dt a cube and then 3 a square a dot pi. So let me combine this. I think this is trying to do it in one step. Sum over I. Let's take 1 over t outside. 1 over t outside. So I write, I combine this d dt, okay, you see this one, okay, and this one I can write it as d dt of rho I a cube. Okay? D rho I dt times a cube and 3 a square a dot times 2 y. I combine this. Then I have this one plus 3 a square a dot p I. And then I have these terms. Minus mu I. Mu I am going to write in terms of this. So let me do this. Minus sum over L C I L U tilde L. And then I have d n I d t times a cube plus 3 a square a dot n I. So that's this. So this one I have taken into account, and then these two terms are here.
Finally, you are writing that also like the first term, rho I a cube. Here you will also say n I a cube, d dt of.
Yes, I can write, I'll write it in the next step.
Okay.
D dt of n I a cube. So now you see that by the energy conservation equation here, this line is 0. Sum over I, right? That's the energy conservation equation. Right? So this is 0. So you get minus 1 over T. Oh, I erased something that I needed. Anyway. So I now use the fact that these are just constants. CILs are just constants. Right? So CIL times NI, sum over I. Okay? This sum over I is our conserved charge, N tilde L. Sum over CIL NI is N tilde I. Right? So the second line I can write as minus 1 over T D sum over L D dt of N tilde L A cube. Is this clear? I've done several steps at a time, but it's basically C I L N I. I've written as N tilde L both here as well as here. Okay, D C I L is of course just constant, so D D T just goes back and forth through C I L. Okay. And then dni dt times a cube and 3 a square a dot ni, I can write as a whole, d dt of ni a cube.
There will be also mu l term.
What term?
Mu l t.
Oh, mu l term, yes, thank you. Sum over l, mu t die. Yes. Yes, but those happen at discrete steps, right? That means you are going from one regime to another regime, right? So that's like, I mean, as we were saying, that changing from this equation to separate energy conservation equation, right? So we are not talking about those, right? In those cases, entropies can change. Okay, so I'm assuming that CILs are fixed for a given regime. And so this is 0. This is 0 by these equations. Which is this one. This one. Okay. So this shows that the entropy is conserved during the evolution. This is useful because often during the evolution we will see that the system is in thermal equilibrium, okay, but the equations become complicated in the middle, okay, so we cannot quite analytically evolve it, okay, but the equations may look simple at the beginning and at the end, okay, And you can figure out what, how to connect them simply by comparing the entropies of the two systems. The entropy expression often is, can be simple at the beginning, simple at the end, but not so simple in the middle. And in those cases, the entropy conservation is very useful. Okay, and we'll see examples of this later.
So, with the evolution of the universe, the entropy will be scaled by 1 by a cube.
Entropy will be scaled by 1 over a cube, as long as the condition for thermal equilibrium is not violated. The second aspect that I want to discuss is the relationship. Relations. Between views for particle and anti. Let me explain what I mean by this. So far, we have been talking about these different species, okay, with I running from 1 to k. Okay. And this includes particles and antiparticles as different species. Okay. That I equal to 1 may correspond to some particle, I equal to 2 may correspond to its antiparticle. Right? Because electrons and positrons, for example, are being counted differently. Okay. So electron has its own mu, positron has its own mu. Yeah, and then eventually they are related by this kind of relation. Okay, the mu, all the mu's are given in terms of the mu tilde ions. But now we want to see if there is a relationship between the mu's for particles and antiparticles. Okay. So let's suppose, and this is the underlying assumption here, that the annihilation rate, particle antiparticle annihilation and creation rates, is faster than the expansion rate. Okay. So suppose A is a particle and A bar is the antiparticle. So there are interactions of this kind, of course. But we assume that this rate is faster than the expansion. This is the regime we are considering. Now, remember the general formula? Had a formula for conserved charges, N tilde L, sum over I, CLI, NI. Then we wrote in terms of capital N, but this is the same as for small n. This is the density, expression for the conserved charge density, charge densities. Now, if this is really true, that this is an equilibrium, then it is easy to convince yourself that these CLs for particles and antiparticles must be equal and opposite. Okay. Namely, particle and antiparticle, okay, contributes oppositely to any conserved charge. Is that clear from this? Hey, suppose it didn't contribute oppositely to the contact charge, right? Take a particle, antiparticle. Suppose particle carries charge Q, antiparticle carries charge Q prime. Okay. Then they annihilate into radiation. Okay. So initially the charge was Q plus Q prime. Finally there's no charge because everything has gone to radiation, right? So unless Q and minus Q prime are opposite, you will violate conservation law. Okay. So it must be that the conserved charges get equal and opposite contribution from particle and antiparticle. So this means that I can write this as saying that this is like sum over I. Okay. Now let's, here the sum over I was running over all spaces, particles, antiparticles separately. Now let's run it over particles. Alpha is a particular particle spaces and its antiparticle will be counted together. So I can write this as CL alpha times n alpha minus n bar alpha. Okay, this would be, so alpha includes, you are not counting particle and antiparticle separately, okay, but this is just capturing the fact that the particle and antiparticle contributes equally and oppositely to any conserved charge.
And radiation is neutral under.
Radiation is neutral. Because number of a bunch of photons can always change their number, right? There's a conserved charge associated with a bunch of photons. So is this clear?
So we are assuming that there is no other process in which this A or A prime can produce or destroy it.
No, there can be. There can be.
Then,
whatever the other processes, right? A conserved charge means what? That any process should conserve it, right? This is a process. A plus A bar is going through radiation, right? So whatever the conserved charge, it must be preserved by this, right? And if it didn't appear in the combination N alpha minus N alpha bar, right, then you know that you can change N alpha and N alpha bar by one, right, and produce radiation, right? That is an allowed process. So if you change N alpha by one and N alpha bar by one, right, and if this has to remain unchanged, then the better term is opposite sign.
So say for the particle and antiparticle which does not have charge, like neutrino, antineutrino kind of thing. So for that case, what will be the scenario?
Well, this may be zero. These may be zero.
Okay.
Yeah, that's perfectly allowed. Okay. There are particles which do not contribute to the conserved charge. Okay. But if they do, its antiparticle must contribute opposite.
Alpha
is for, I mean, so sum over alpha basically means that for electron and positron will not include separate sums.
Yeah.
Right? So if alpha is the electron, right, positron is also included in this.
Okay. Differently we don't have to.
Yeah, differently we don't sum over. So this sum runs over roughly half of this sum.
Okay.
Except that in some case, some particles may be their own antiparticles, right?
Right.
In which case this means this sum, but there will be no contribution at all. If a particle is its own antiparticle, then it cannot contribute to conserved charge. Because two of those can just disappear into radiation.
Right.
Right?
But this kind of interaction, we know that n minus n bar is a good quantum number because that doesn't change.
No, it may change. There are other processes.
Oh.
Right? So it's not that every n alpha minus n alpha bar is a good quantum number. Because muon decays into electrons and neutrinos, right?
Mm-hmm. So then the numbers.
So number of muons by itself is not a good quantum number, right? Even the number of muons minus anti-muons is not a good quantum number. Okay. So not every n minus n bar is a good quantum number, but any good quantum number must be a linear combination of these. And that's what it is saying. Okay. And so now we can work out what this thing is, mu tilde L, this will tell us how to relate the different mu's. So this is sum over L, mu tilde L, sum over alpha, CL alpha times N alpha minus N over alpha. So I can rewrite this as sum over alpha, L, mu tilde L, CL alpha times N alpha minus N bar alpha. We just reorganization. But I also define this as sum over alpha, mu alpha N alpha plus mu bar alpha N bar alpha. That's the definition of mu alpha, right? Whatever multiplies in this exponent of the grand canonical ensemble, right? Whatever multiplies N alpha is what we are calling mu alpha. Okay. So if you now compare this with this, then mu alpha is this combination and mu bar alpha is negative of this combination. Okay. So this tells us that mu bar alpha is minus mu alpha. That's the relation I have to get. That if the particle antiparticle annihilation happens at a rate that is faster than the rate of expansion of the universe, then the mu's that they carry have to be equal and opposite.
Sir, for this neutrino and anti-neutrino, why it should be zero? They have some other quantum number.
No, I'm not saying that it is zero.
Okay.
Right? It could be zero.
Okay.
It is true. See, they don't carry electric charge. Right? So as far as electric charge is concerned, their contribution is zero. But there may be other quantum numbers, right? Lepton number, for example, right? They do contribute to lepton number.
Yes.
Right? Which is a conserved charge. And so they do contribute to that charge. See, it's not that neutral particle, the electrically neutral particles never contribute to any conserved quantum number. Okay? They can contribute to conserved quantum number. But what is always true is that the contribution of neutrino and antineutrino will be opposite.
So, where is this Adamson project here? Where the rate is faster than the expansion rate?
Oh, because we are saying that this process is allowed, right? Suppose the rate is slower than the expansion rate, right? Then there is no annihilation, right? Then you can ignore that annihilation process, right? Then the number of A itself can be conserved, right? That certainly doesn't satisfy this, right? If you take the conserved charge, which is just the number of A, right? Without worrying about number of A bar, right? There A bar and A do not contribute equal or opposite, right? Because you are just counting the number of A's and not number of A bars. So it's only when the system, this process is in equilibrium, right? The annihilation of particle antiparticle, that this statement is true.
Sir,
yes.
Here the alpha goes from different species, one species to another.
Yes.
Now, in this equation, if you break the first equation, only sum over I,
yes,
to the sum over alpha,
that's
that
right.
Means that all the species, all the reactions that are going on, all in the same manner, the A plus A bar goes to radiation.
Oh, there may be other reactions also.
Right.
But this reaction is there for every alpha.
Okay. For every alpha,
this reaction is there.
Okay. Right.
That's the assumption. The particle and antiparticle,
yes,
right? It's only those alphas which will come in this combination.
Right.
So this statement is true for those alphas for which this is possible.
Okay.
Okay. Otherwise, the coefficient of N alpha and N bar alpha will be different.
Different, yes. No, actually, that I am confused about the fact that where the other interactions that are taking place are taken into account.
Oh, that is CILs, C alpha Ls, which, okay. See, there may not be any conserved charge at all, right?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
In which case, all the Cs are just zero. There's no conserved charge. That's also possible, right? So the other interactions are important in determining which are the conserved charges.
Okay. Understood.
That is correct. So this earlier also you could have asked the same thing, right? Where are the interactions important, right? The CILs are determined by what are the possible processes, right? More processes you have, the less number of conserved charges you will have.
Right.
Because every process can violate some conservation law.
Okay. So you are saying that the processes that are allowed for all A's,
yes,
are also allowed for, according the processes, for A bars also.
Need not be. Need not be. Suppose it's not.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
According to CPD, certain things are of course allowed, but not every reaction of A is not the same as a reaction of A bar.
Right.
Doesn't matter. I'm not assuming in this argument that A and A bar interact in the same way.
Okay.
All I'm assuming is that there is a particular process in which A plus A bar can go to nothing. Okay? So let's imagine that there is a conserved charge. Okay? Which gets unequal contribution from A and A bar.
Yeah. So
okay?
Right.
Then that is not conserved.
Yes.
Just by this process. See, as long as there is one process which violates a conservation law, right?
Yes.
It's enough to show that is not a conserved charge. Right? So any combination of N alpha and N alpha bar that doesn't come in this structure, right? That will be violated by this process. Right? It may be conserved in other processes. It doesn't matter. Right? As long as this process violates it, it's not a conserved charge.
Right.
Yeah, that's why every conservation law must include this combination, N alpha minus N bar alpha. See, conservation laws are not in one-to-one correspondence with the processes, right? The more processes there are, the less conservation laws you have.
Yeah, right.
But every process has the potential to violate some conservation law.
Right.
Is that clear? Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Now, let's go back to our cosmological equations again. So the cosmological, so this is third observation, the cosmological equations have a simple solution which is n alpha minus n1 alpha equal to 0. Every particle species has the same number of particles and antiparticles. If the particle is its own antiparticle, then of course there is no constant. It can be anything.
So then how many number?
Pardon?
Then the asymmetries of the
many. Well, I didn't say that our universe is of this kind, right? I'm just saying that the cosmological equations have one solution, which is this.
Okay.
Right? Not that we are of this kind. Is this clear? So what Lippmann is saying, that this may be a solution, but this is not what describes us, right? Because you know there are more protons than antiprotons in the universe, right? So you don't have equal number of protons and antiprotons. Okay, but the claim is that this is one particular class of solutions. Okay, you have to put appropriate initial condition, of course, to get this solution. Okay. So how do we see this? That this is a solution. Okay. You see, if we set this equal to 0, okay, then this set of L equations you automatically satisfy. All the conservation laws are automatically satisfied because all conserved charges are linear combinations of these, right? Okay. So if you set this equal to 0 for every species, right, then all conservation laws are automatically satisfied. So conservation laws are satisfied. The number conservation laws. The number conservation laws satisfied. we have to check that you have the correct number of variables, right? So you are left with two equations, right? We have to solve the Friedman equation. And energy conservation equation. Okay, so you have to make sure that after setting this, we still have enough number of equations left over. Or enough number of variables left over so that you can solve this. So let's see how many variables we have, and for this you have to do a little more work to figure out what the mu's are doing. So let me write down the expression for n that we used got last time. So this is going to be given by g alpha over 2 pi squared integral dk k squared e to the power minus beta. Okay, this is the same formula that we did about last time. G alpha now is the number of states per particle, for the alpha particle. N bar alpha is given by the same formula, except that mu is replaced by mu bar. M is the same, right? Because particle and antiparticle have the same mass by CPT. And now I use the previous formula to set mu bar alpha equal to mu bar minus mu alpha. Right? So you use the fact that mu bar alpha equal to minus mu alpha to write this as plus mu alpha plus mu alpha.
So is this equation valid also for boson?
Yeah, for boson the minus sign is for the boson and plus sign is for the formula.
What's the value of G alpha for boson?
Well, if it's a scalar, it's 1. If it's a photon, it's 2. Because photon has 2 helicities, right? For fermion, it's 2. For Dirac fermion. So that's how you should count.
Is 10 multiplicity factor that you mentioned?
Exactly, the multiplicity factor, right? How many states, how many polarization states are there per particle? Is this okay? So we can see from this formula that we can set, we can satisfy the n alpha equal to n alpha bar simply by setting mu alpha equal to 0. Right? So then we knew that for every species, we have 2 variables, right? Which can take to be t and mu. Mu's have all been set equal to 0, right? So that's gone. We are in equilibrium, so all the temperatures are equal. Right? So the intrinsic thermodynamic variable is only 1, t. So leftover variables, T and A. Okay. So basically, we use these two equations to solve for those two variables. No, it is some, there may be some combinations which are conserved quantities.
Okay.
Yeah. Here the point is, because the way you have set up the particular solution, right, all conserved quantities are automatically zero. So everything is conserved. Okay. Some follows as a consequence of conservation laws. Some follows, the rest follows as a consequence of the initial condition that you have chosen. Okay. I have chosen the initial condition to make all the charges zero. All whether conserved charges or not non-conserved charges, right? Any combination n alpha minus n alpha, but I have said equal to zero. Right? Some of them, some linear combinations of these are actually conserved. Right? For all initial conditions, that has to be conserved. Right? But for this particular initial condition, we have imposed also others being conserved. Right? It's not a consequence of the original equations of motion. It's a consequence of the way we have set up the initial condition. Is that? Because during the dynamics, right, some things may not change, even though it's not conserved, right? Something may not change simply because of the initial condition. Right? I mean, let's suppose that we have a harmonic oscillator, right? And we consider a solution where x is equal to zero. X obviously is not a conserved quantity, right? But for that particular solution, x is zero. Right? It is conserved. The x doesn't change, right? So here, that's what we have done, that we have chosen the initial conditions in such a way that n alpha minus n alpha bar are all zero, okay, even though not all of them are conserved.
So the leftover variables, you are saying that these are to be determined by the two equations, one is sigma and one is energy.
The energy conservation. Right? Because everything now, because of mu have been set equal to zero, right? In the energy conservation, you have rho and p.
Right.
Those can now all be thought of as functions of t only, because the corresponding mu's are zero.
Right.
So you can use the equation of state to express rho and p in terms of t,
yes,
and solve the Friedman equation.
Yes.
Is this clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, you may wonder why you are doing this, because obviously our universe is not like this, right? Our universe has variable number. Number of protons is not the same as number of antiprotons.
Okay.
Nevertheless, for most of what you want to do, this is sufficient.
Okay.
And the one way to see this, okay, you can do a simple calculation that we know that today, of course, we have certain density of protons in the universe, right? Now, if we go back in time, we have seen earlier that the radiation, the energy density content in radiation, becomes comparable to that of matter at some point. Right? You remember at what temperature that happens? About 10 to the 4 Kelvin. Okay, today is 2.73, right? But early in the history of the universe, at 10 to the 4 Kelvin,
okay,
the radiation energy density is the same as the matter energy density.
Okay.
Now, before that, the radiation energy density would have been much more than the matter energy density.
Okay.
So, the actual thermodynamics that is controlled, the main contribution,
okay,
to the evolution equations, okay, will basically come from the radiation and also the particle-antiparticle pairs that it may produce, right, at sufficiently high energy. That radiation, of course, will not remain only as radiation. It will also have particle-antiparticle pair.
Okay.
But their number will be much, much larger than the number of excess protons that you have.
Okay.
Yeah, their contribution to energy density, okay, just like the radiation contribution to energy density, right, far above 10 to the 4 K, will be much larger than the matter contribution.
Okay.
Similarly, all other contributions, right, which are produced in particle-antiparticle pair in the early universe, their contribution of energy density, which will be comparable to that of the radiation contribution, will be much larger than the one that is contributed by these few excess protons that we have in our universe. Okay. So while it is true that in our universe this is not strictly true, okay, where it's relevant, okay, where this equation will be relevant, the contribution to n minus n bar, the right hand side, will be so small, okay, that we can ignore it for all practical purposes.
No, but sir, after solving this two energy equation, one energy equation and one Friedman equation, we will get some T.
Yes.
So we can we say that at that T, at that temperature, the universe is something like that, where we can say n alpha minus n alpha bar would be zero.
Almost zero.
Almost zero.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. Because the point is the number of, so what do you mean almost zero, right? We know what right hand side is.
Yeah.
Right? Because right hand side, we know how much excess proton we have today.
Right.
Right?
Right.
So from that, we can calculate how much excess proton we have in our universe.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
So at that temperature, okay, at the temperature that will be working,
right,
we can also calculate n alpha and n alpha bar.
Okay.
Okay? Assuming mu is almost, mu is zero, you can calculate n alpha and n alpha bar. Now, because of these excess protons,
yes,
okay, of course our argument is not totally correct, mu alpha will be corrected,
right,
right? But n alpha and n alpha bar that we'll calculate,
right,
will be much larger than the excess that we have.
So, right, right.
So, n alpha minus n alpha bar will turn out to be much smaller than the n alpha and n alpha bar itself. That's the reason why you can ignore the excess protons, even though you know that it's not strictly true that n alpha and n alpha bar are slightly different. For the protons and for the electrons.
So I would have expected, means as the time progresses, these dynamic variables will evolve.
Yes.
At some point, we would have to consider the system. Means we
yes.
can't be neglecting this.
I agree. But at that time,
we can do that.
Yeah. At that time, we will not do all this
yeah.
we are doing, right? Because at that time, the temperature has gotten so low
that
thermodynamics will be irrelevant.
So in the limit in which we are doing things, this is the
exactly.
good enough
effort. That's right. Is this point clear?
And also, sir, in this case, when the temperature is so low, then the cosmological cost will be better.
Yeah, but there is a lot of, part of the evolution of the universe, right? You know, major part of the evolution of the universe in the recent past is matter dominated. Right? So certainly, that contribution does dominate at some point. Right? So I'm not saying that this never dominates the history of the universe, right? Evolution. Right? But where you'll be applying this thermodynamic consideration, right? In those regimes, right, where there is a lot of particles and antiparticles produced, in those regimes, you can ignore this excess contribution. Is this clear? Okay, then the next thing we'll study. So we'll be working within this approximation, all the mu zero, right? That will make life much simpler because calculations will be easier. I'll explain what non-relativistic particles mean. So it basically means that at temperature much, much less than m. Okay, I'm not dropping the index alpha, but it's valid for every space separately. So let me write down the formula for n. this is the same formula that we wrote earlier. Now, we are considering the case where beta times m is very large. So this exponential factor is very small, e to the minus beta. This is at least as large as m, right? This is very small. And as k is increasing, it's falling off even faster. Larger k means even smaller number like this, right? And in that limit, in fact, you can ignore this factor because it's already small, e to the minus beta. Okay. So we'll approximate this by g over 2 pi square integral 0 to infinity dk k square. Okay, only the top will be here. And here I'll expand this as beta m plus k square by beta. Okay, and then other terms we don't worry about. This is the non-relativistic formula for the energy, right? Response plus kinetic term. So this can be calculated g over 2 pi square e to the power minus beta n. Okay, we can just scale out k. So we can write k as square root of 2 m by beta times u. Let's change variable. So you get 2 m by beta to the power 3/2 times integral 0 to infinity du. Oh, because this is very small, right? E to the minus beta m, I'm assuming that beta m, so this means beta m is large, right?
Right, right.
Okay. So because it's very small, I just replace it by 1.
Okay. Compared to 1, it is negative.
Compared to 1, it's negative. So what this is saying, okay, so this is just a number, right? You don't, yeah, some finite number. The important part is this one, e to the minus m beta or e to the minus m over t. Right? This is the Boltzmann suppression factor. So what this is saying is that as the temperature is coming down, once the temperature falls below the mass of the particle, the number density of particles start decreasing rapidly. Okay, simply because the photons, okay, see how is the particle in equilibrium? The particles are of course always annihilating, right? A bar going to radiation and the radiation is colliding to pr produce particles. But once the temperature falls below that m, the effective photon energies are becoming less than m, right? So now it's not so easy to produce particles in the collision, right? Only at the tail of the distribution where the photons have large energy can have collision to produce particles. On the other hand, the particles continue to annihilate, right, whenever they meet each other. And that's the reason why the number density of particles is going down rapidly as e to the minus beta m. So once the temperature falls below the mass of the particle, say within a factor of 5m, the number density of particles reduces drastically. Okay, so for example, if we are starting from say 2 GeV, temperature of 2 GeV, right, and then as the temperature is falling, at 2 GeV, there are lots of particles. Well, maybe this is not a good example. Let's say 0.5 MeV, 1 MeV. Suppose temperature is 1 MeV. Right? At 1 MeV, there will be electron-positron pair. Right? But once the temperature falls below the electron-positron pair, the mass of the electron, right? Say 0.5 MeV. Then the number density of electrons and positrons start reducing drastically. Okay? And by the time you come to, for example, 0.1 MeV, right? The number density has gone down tremendously. So at that time, at that stage, you can simply ignore the existence of electrons and positrons. Okay. When you calculate the partition function, the thermodynamics, you simply ignore the fact that there are particles like electrons and positrons. Is this clear?
there is some t to the power 3 by 2 part also here.
Yeah, but that's multiplying it. You see, that's multiplying it.
Okay.
Right? This is an exponential suppression.
Yeah.
Right? So for small t, this decreases, I mean, this is not going to compensate for that.
Right, right. This is always dominant.
Yeah, exactly. Right? So that's falling off very rapidly. So the general rule is that, see, strictly we have the sum over all species of particles, right? When you calculate the log q, it's sum over I log qi, right? The sum over all particles. Okay. But the contribution to log qi, okay, I calculated here n, but you can do a similar calculation for log q or p. Okay, there'll be a similar suppression. The contribution to the partition function, okay, from particles whose masses are much larger than the temperature that you're working with is negligible. So, effectively, we can simply ignore the existence of those particles. See, if we couldn't do that, then you couldn't do thermodynamics, right? Because we don't know how many particles are there above 100 GeV, right? At 5 GeV, there may be lots of particles. And if you have to take into account their effect to do thermodynamics, right, then you couldn't do anything. Okay? So, it's just as well that their contribution just falls off. This we couldn't have done if there are excess particles, right? Because suppose the number density of protons was not so small, right? Huge number density. Then even below the proton temperature, okay, you couldn't ignore the existence of certain number of protons, right? Yeah. And the way we have to get it, right, is by adjusting mu, right? That here you have e to the minus beta m, right? But the mu we have set equal to zero, right? Because we have using the fact that the number of protons and antiprotons are equal. If the number of protons and antiprotons are not equal, right, but some given number, then you have to adjust mu to compensate for this e to the minus beta m factor. Okay, but as I said, fortunately for us, we don't have to do that. Is this clear?
It's some sort of chemical kinetics coming into the picture. If one of the species is very quite a bit, then the forward reaction and backward reaction would
exactly. So that's the effect that is mu is representing. So those are there just because of conservation law, right? Not because they are actually produced in fire collision of photons. Now there is a corollary to this, that when the temperature is really small, okay, then the number density falls to such a low value, okay, that the rate of annihilation becomes smaller than the expansion rate. It will eventually happen, right? Because after all, how do the particles annihilate, right? If there is a gas of A and A bar, right? A is traveling around inside the gas, right? And it annihilates whenever it meets an A bar. Okay? It cannot annihilate otherwise. But if the number of A bars become very, very small, right, then A is not encountering A bar that often, right? And at some point, the rate at which A meets A bar becomes smaller than the expansion rate of the universe. Okay? In that case, this process stops. Okay? So then this number freezes. Okay, we still have a 1 over A cube, of course, right? Now, so from then that point onwards, you can think of the number of A's as a conserved quantity, okay, and apply ddt of a cube equal to 0. So this is often referred to as the relic density. Okay. So the dark matter that we see, right, could be of this kind. Okay, we don't know what the nature of dark matter is, but at some point, okay, it would have decoupled from the system. Okay, its annihilation would have gotten out of equilibrium, right? Annihilation rate would have become weaker than the expansion rate. And then that, whatever remains, okay, is believed to be dark matter.
Those are heavy particles.
Those are typically heavy particles. Right? But there are various other models of dark matter also. Right? This is one particular scenario, okay, of what dark matter particles would be. That they just didn't, that there are some relics, but didn't have enough strong enough interaction to annihilate completely. Right? And so there is some density of them that is remaining. These we'll discuss in more detail later. Okay, now let me just give the other formula, which is the relativistic case. So for beta very large, for beta very large, basically you can ignore the same.
This is same.
Sorry. Beta very small. P is much larger.
Beta is
1
by n?
Beta is 1 over t.
Yeah.
Sorry. What did I do?
T is
beta is less than m inverse.
Yeah.
So in this limit, when the temperature is very large compared to the mass of the particle, we can effectively think of the particles as massless. Okay, we just said m equal to 0 and do our calculation. So basically, you can see that there is basically one dimensional ratio that is important here, right? And that is combination of m over t. K is of course just an integration variable. Right? So the whole thing is just a function of m over t. So large t also means small m. So in this case, so you can write, okay, let's write the formula for p over t, which is log q. Or 1 over t log q. So this is minus plus d over 2 pi square integral dk a square log 1 minus plus e power minus beta. I'll just say minus beta k. Okay. Now we can just change variable beta k to u, we get minus plus g over 2 pi square integral, then so k is u by t, u over beta, which is u times t, right? So g over 2 pi square times t cube integral du u square log of 1 minus plus to the minus e. Okay. This number you can easily calculate. So you just put it in mathematical to figure out what it is. So this is pi to the 4 over 45 for bosons. And pi to the 4 over 45 multiply by 7/8 for fermions. Sorry. Minus, because ultimately the minus sign cancels. Okay, so you get basically g over 2 pi square pq times pi to the 4 over 45 times 1 for boson and 7 over 8 for fermion. You can calculate, we don't have to calculate by the old formula, you can just use this thermodynamic relation. So this basically always gives TP. Okay, so 3 comes because of the fact that there's a T cube, right? The formula for P over T. When you take del del T, you get 3 times T square. Right? And then this factor of T square converts it back to T to the 4. Right? Which is the same as P. So this is the formula, P equal to rho by 3. Right? Which you are familiar with for radiation. But this formula is valid also for formulas.
It's very large compared to the mass.
Yeah, when the temperature is very large compared to the mass. Is this okay? So one writes this in terms of this constant AB, which is just pi square over 15. So let me write this formula in terms of this. So with this P, oh, I forgot the G, I think. No, this is fine. So P is given basically by G over 6 AB T to the 4 times 1 for boson and 7/8 for fermion. Okay, I could have just defined AF as 7/8 times AB.
Is that pi to the power 4 by 15 or pi to the power 2 by 15?
No, pi square, because that pi to the 4 and there is one more pi square here.
Oh, okay, right. So next.
So these combine it to become pi square. So rho is just 3 times this, G over 2, A, B, T, 4, times 1 for boson, times 7 by 8 for fermion. And then the entropy is 1 over T times P plus rho minus mu n, right? This is the general formula, but mu is 0. So this basically gives you 2/3 G P cube times 1 for boson and 7/8 for fermion. Basically comes from P plus rho. Right? The 2/3 is 1/2 plus 1/6. That gives you 2/3. Is this clear? Well, that's just for fermions. I mean, it's the number of degrees of fermion is effectively 7/8 times that of a boson. It's just statistics, right? Okay, so let me just take a few minutes to say how it will be used. Okay, all that we have done today, I mean, this is just a collection of results. Okay, but let's try to say how we can use it. So let's suppose that you have some radiation dominated area. Say a temperature 10 times half the electron mass. 10 MeV, say, right? Then it will be basically electrons are behaving massless, right? So there will be a certain number of species which will contribute, electrons, neutrinos, and whatever you can think of. Electron means electrons and positrons because the temperature is 10 MeV. So we know that it's radiation dominated. Okay. And if we start substituting the Friedman equation, you will find that temperature falls as 1 over A. And you know how A changes as a function of time. Okay? Then the temperature starts reducing. As time evolves, the temperature starts reducing. And let's suppose that we come down to a temperature that is about 1/10 the electron mass. Okay? 0.05 MeV. At that time, the electrons have decoupled. Right? The electron contribution is negligible. Neutrinos are still very much there. Photons are there. So again, the evolution is as if it's radiation dominated. Right? You can write down the equations that determine the evolution. Okay, how A changes as a function of time, and T again falls as a one over A. But now the problem is that how to connect the equations that was valid above electron temperature and the equations that are valid below the electron temperature, right? Both have similar looking equations. Both are radiation dominated. Okay. But in between, it was not radiation dominated because when the temperature was of the order of the electron mass, then the electrons were massive particles, right? You couldn't have used this formula that we derived here. Neither could you have used the other formula and thrown away the electron contribution, right? Because the temperature is not really very small compared to the electron mass, right? It's of the order of the electron mass. So the question will be, how do we connect the data from before, above electron mass, to the data below electron mass? Now, one possibility, of course, to just do a brute force calculation, right? Of course, I mean, we know the partition function, right? Even though it looks complicated, we can just calculate the partition function and substitute the Friedman equation. But there is a simpler way to do this. So what is that simpler way?
Find the entropy before and after.
Yeah, so find the entropy before and after. Right? The entropy formula is given. And you know that even though the electrons have decoupled, we are all through in equilibrium. Right? Because you are not assuming that we are deviating from thermal equilibrium. That will start that may start happening much later when the electrons stop annihilating. Okay. By that time, electron contribution is negligible anyway. Okay. So we can use thermal equilibrium and hence entropy conservation to say that the STQ or SAQ is conserved. Okay. We know the formula for S. Okay. And using that, we can relate the T A above the electron temperature to T above below the electron temperature. Okay. And that's the way you can connect through this transition, without actually doing detailed calculation. But of course, if you do the detailed calculation, you will find the same result. Is this clear? Okay. And we will see next time that this actually has a non-trivial consequence. Okay. And that comes from the fact that the neutrinos decouple above the electron temperature. Neutrinos stop being in thermal equilibrium above the electron temperature. Okay. So the neutrinos become decoupled components. Okay. Now, as we discussed last time, that even after the neutrinos are of course almost massless particles, right? So even after the neutrinos decouple, their distribution continues to evolve as a thermal distribution. Right? T falls off as 1 over A. Right? So as long as the system in equilibrium is in radiation dominated era, okay, both will continue to have the same temperature because both are falling as 1 over A. Okay. One is falling as 1 over A because of the thermal equilibrium, because of the equations that are governing the system. The other one simply because of the stretching. Okay. Not that neutrinos are not in thermal equilibrium anymore, but just by stretching it, T is of order 1 over A. But the system which is in thermal equilibrium, the electrons and other things, other stuff, photons, they do not always obey the same law, T proportional to 1 over A, because they are at some point going through this non-radiation regime, right? When the temperature of the order of the electron mass. After that transition, after that yeah, again T becomes proportional to 1 over A. Okay. But the proportionality constant can change because of this fact that in the middle it has gone through this other era. Okay. But the precise change, of course, you can find by matching the entropy. So what we will find is that the neutrino and the effectively, okay, this calculation we'll do more carefully. Okay. What we'll find effectively is the neutrino temperature and the photon temperature after this decoupling of the electrons become different.
So decoupling of neutrons.
Pardon?
Decoupling of neutrons.
Yeah. So the neutrons have decoupled before the above the electron temperature, right? Okay. So they continue to fall as 1 over A. Okay, that's just kinematics. Okay, the wavelength is getting stretched. The other one is evolving through thermodynamics. Okay. There, T proportional to 1 over A is valid in the radiation regime, okay, but not when it's going through this transition where the temperature of the order of the electron mass.
Oh, okay.
Right? So after it has gone through that regime, right, again T becomes proportional to 1 over A. Okay. But for the same A, now you don't have the same T for the neutrino and the electron and the photon. Okay. And that ratio survives even till today. Okay. So today that's the reason why I had stated it without giving the proof that the neutrino temperature is different from the electron temperature. Okay, and that is due to this fact. Okay, and next week we'll calculate precisely this ratio. Okay, what is the ratio of the neutrino temperature and the electron temperature? Okay. We know this even though we have not observed this cosmic microwave background neutrino. But if we observe them, so we should find them at this temperature.
You were saying that when the decoupling happens, the density is negligible.
Hmm.
But for dark matter, the density is not negligible.
Even for dark matter, density is negligible because the matter radiation equality, right, was including the dark matter. At 10 to the 4 Kelvin, the matter energy density and the radiation energy density becomes equal. Right, 10 to the 4 Kelvin is some about 1 electron volt, right? And we are working at the order of MeV, right? That's why much of the interaction thermodynamics is going on. Right? So at MeV scale, that's about 10 to the 6 times more, right? So the energy density in the radiation by that time is 10 to the 6 times more than the energy density in matter. Right? So that's why the matter is negligible. The excess matter that we have, right, contributes negligibly to the evolution equations, right, because the radiation energy density is much more. That includes the dark matter.
Okay.
Right? I mean, why did you say it?
I mean, the omega of a dark matter is like 25% of it.
That's today.
Okay.
Yeah, that's today, but in the early universe, right?
Okay.
The radiation energy density would have been much more.
Okay.
Because the ratio of the radiation to matter energy density, right, goes as 1 over A.
Mm.
Right? Because radiation energy density falls as 1 over A to the 4, and matter energy density falls as 1 over A cube.
Okay.
Right? So when A was very small,
mm-hmm,
right, radiation energy density would have been much more than the matter energy density.
Mm.
Any other question?
In this last derivation, when we took T much less than 1,
yes.
So, but we are still in this radiation dominated era, or no?
Yes, because typically what happens when T is much less than M, right? There are other particles which are photon is always massless, right? So we are still in the radiation dominated era, right? Because the photons give the maximum contribution. That's why when T is much larger than M, we are in radiation dominated era, because we can think of this particle as non-relativistic particle. When T is much less than M, we are still in radiation dominated era, because the contribution from this particle is negligible, right? Because their densities are so small. It's only when T is of order M that we cannot say that we are in radiation dominated era, right? Because when T is of order M, then the equation of state is not P equal to rho by 3. Right? It's a much more complicated equation of state, and that is contributing. That contribution is of order 1, right? It's comparable to the other components. understand? That's why you are not radius. We can use radius and domination formula much above the above m and much below m, right, for different reasons, but not 20s of order m. And that's where this difference comes in, right? Otherwise, the photon and the neutrinos would have evolved in the same way. So physically, what happens is that at the decoupling, right, the energy was equally shared between photons, electrons, all degrees of freedom shared equally, right? Formulas at the 7-8, but let's not worry about that too much. Okay. Then the neutrinos decoupled, right? Everything else started evolving. Okay. But once the electrons decoupled, right? Basically what happens is, what do you mean with electrons decoupling? Right? Electrons decoupling means that the photons don't have enough energy to produce electron-positron pair, but electron-positron pair actually produces photons, right? So effectively the photon temperature goes up. Okay. It goes above what it would have been if you had assumed that it's the radius in domain out. Because the electron-positron energy, after analyzing that, gets converted to photon. Then you don't see it directly because you are using the thermal equilibrium formula, right? But physically, that's what is happening. Okay. So one says that the photon temperature is higher than the neutrino temperature because it got heated up during the electron-positron decoupling. Right? Because electron-positron pairs annihilated and created photons.
So the fact that neutrinos decouple at that temperature is a coincidence of the standard model coupling. And
that's that, yeah. So next time we'll try to estimate at what temperature the neutrinos decouple, and we'll find that at around 10 MeV is when they start decoupling, and not 10, below 10 MeV, right? But above the electron mass. Yeah, so it's just an accident of standard model coupling.